All right, welcome to Let There Be Talk. This is Dean Del Rey live from the Beechwood Canyon right here on a hot sunny day.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my guest Scoop McNairy. What's going on, buddy?
Not much, my man. Good times. Good to see you.
Yeah, you too, man. I haven't seen you. I see you about once a year, right?
Yeah. But, man, we've known each other 8 years.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Long time.
Well, we met on the at the Gower House.
Lower Gower, LGP.
Yeah.
The Lower Gower piece. Yeah, man, like about 8 years ago.
And, I mean, Scoot is a friend of mine, kind of Hollywood style, one of those guys that you meet when you you move here or whatever, and then you kind of run into him like once every, you know, two, 3 months.
We're both talkers, you know what I mean? So the second I met you, we just started chatting each other up.
That's right.
We're both kind of, I feel like, guys that just talk to anybody.
Yeah. So the reason I want to have you on is... I was seeing The Master a couple nights ago.
Okay.
And bam, there you are. Huge trailer with Brad Pitt.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, this, I mean, I know you're an actor. I mean, I did that table read with you. You had that kind of cool hipster Cheers show you were going to do.
Yeah, and then, you know, commercials for about...
Forever?
10 years.
Which ones?
I mean, so many, man.
Yeah.
Like, down to Levi's, Coors Light, Chevy, you know, anything. They you know, anything. Think.
Yeah, so and then you start doing movies, right? I saw you on Midnight Kiss was the first one I saw you on, which was cool.
Yeah, I was getting all these small parts in films, like one-liners, and I was like, man, this is going to go on forever. I got to make my own movie. And so me and some buddies got together and all made that movie, In Search of a Midnight Kiss. Got a little bit of legs.
Yeah, got some heat. Where did it, like, was it Sundance or something loved it?
No, Tribeca is where we premiered, and then we ended up winning an Independent Spirit Award for, like, Cassavetes Award, best movie made under $500,000. Granted, our movie was 10 grand.
Right, 10 grand you made that for. Are you kidding? That thing was great.
Bucks. Yeah, man, thank you.
And how many days you shoot it in?
Man, we shot like for like 9 days. I feel like we shot 75% of the movie over 9 days. And then we came back for 3 days and then came back for 5 days. And even after we screened at Tribeca, we were still we did another 3 reshoots before we like went to print.
And were you just running, gunning, no permits, shit like that?
No permits. The director had headphones on, and if you opened up his jacket, it looked like he had a bomb under there. So we could pretty much go anywhere in Los Angeles and shoot.
And what kind of cameras? Just red cams or 40s?
That one, I feel 5Ds? Like, don't quote me on it, but I think we were using the Sony PD-150.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and it had just come out at the time
when
we were using it.
That film looks great.
Yeah.
Wait, it's really black and white?
Black and white, right. But if you're seeing it on Showtime now, they colored it.
Oh, why?
IFC, you know, I don't know. It's not something that, you know, we were happy about, but, you know, commerce calls, you know.
Yeah. So we'll get to the Brad Pitt film because that's some cool stories there, but you, where are you from, man?
Born and raised Dallas, Texas. Moved down to Austin when I was about 18. Kind of got a little bit of a, you know, itch for the entertainment industry, but it was more cinematography. I was acting in some movies down there, but then, you know, cinematography after I met the DP was like, that's what I want to focus on. And that's kind of what led me out to Los Angeles, was to go to film school.
Wow. You went to film school?
Yeah, I went to film school for a year at the Art Institute of Los Angeles. Figured I'd probably learn more as an extra. Just standing around on a set, so I dropped out, was a carpenter for a while, and then just started doing extra gigs and watching how sets run and how the business works.
How'd you get a commercial agent? Because, like, a lot of people are thinking you just come out here and, I got a commercial agent. I just went in and asked him.
So, well, kind of.
Because it's hard, right?
It's very hard. I mean, like, even now, like, I have some friends that are some of the most phenomenal actors I've ever met, and, like, I can't even get them an agent. It's really frustrating. But my commercial agent came about because when I was a carpenter, the guy next door to the carpentry shop had a floral department, and his best friend was a commercial agent. Wow. So he asked, he said, will you bartend my friend's commercial agency Christmas party? I was like, sure. He's like, how much? He's like, $150. It's like, anything. I was just doing anything for cash.
And hell yeah.
I met him and then came back in January and brought my headshots in. And he was like, what are you doing? And I was like, you're going to represent me. He's like, well, no, I'm not. You're not right.
You're the bartender.
Yeah. And his buddy called, Jesus, and was like, you have to take him on. Please take him on. He's like, no, he's not right for my company. And he's like, fine, I'll take him on.
What's the name of the company?
JPA.
Is still around?
Oh, yeah. He's now my producing partner, my commercial agent, my theatrical manager, and my best friend.
Now, why didn't he think you were right? I mean, all, you got the perfect look for commercials.
Well, it was all he represented all models, like good-looking people, and he was like, you know, you're a little bit more offbeat, and you're not
kind of people like me.
Yeah, exactly, you know, exactly.
So foxy dudes in Hollywood,
just hot dudes. That people when they see you, Dean, they just take their shirt off and scream.
You think I'm Brad Pitt and shit? You know what I mean?
So it ended up working out, man. Like, you know, he took me on, and then I got like 20 jobs the first year, and he was like, shit, man, we should get you a theatrical. And so it was just kind of like a run and gun from there.
Man, I mean, that's, I mean, those commercials, you were kind of doing a lot of commercials when people were making big money on them.
Yeah, back in the, you know, you could slowly see the decline over the last 10 years.
Right.
The last two, I was like, oh, man, we really need to find something else because they're just not paying like they used to pay.
Yeah, like what was the biggest money-wise you had? Because Bobby Lee's a friend of mine. He had a $350,000 payout on one.
Wow.
IBM. Yeah. Unheard of at the time, a buyout.
My biggest one was over the course of about a year and a half, I made about $150,000 on a Chevy commercial that all I did was spin in a chair. You know? So those are the days, man, back when, you know, making good. I didn't have to think about money, and I wasn't a big spender, so, you know what I mean?
You were just buying weed?
It just, you know, not necessarily, but, you know, they spend it on Vegas or, you know what I mean? Just blowing cash as a 24-year-old kid, you know?
Yeah, yeah. How old are you now?
34.
34. So you've been out here how long?
Been out here 11 years.
Yeah, you like it?
Yeah, still liking it. You know, I got a place in Texas, so I'm kind of going back and forth. But
And you bought that?
Yeah, we got a little ranch down there in a little small town in Texas.
You know, got married, right?
Got married to my co-star, Whitney Abel, from Monsters, a film we did together.
Nice. Now, what was Monsters about?
It's kind of like a road movie, alien invasion film, but like more grounded in reality. You know what I mean? It's not so Hollywood studio far-fetched. It's, you know, there's some heart to it. You know, and it came out about 2 years ago. The director is incredible. He's doing the new Godzilla movie now. He went from a $500,000 movie to like a $60 million film.
Oh, yeah. I love Godzilla.
Yeah.
I think there's a certain type of person that likes Godzilla. Don't you think? Like, I don't give a fuck about King Kong, but Godzilla,
Godzilla,
man.
Different story.
Yeah, and Ultraman, too, man. If they make fuck, what's the one, Iron Man? I don't care, but Ultraman, I'm in. That's some weird shit, 60s fucking Japanese stuff.
No, absolutely.
But Godzilla's dope, not the Raymond Burr one. Yeah, that's
well, hopefully,
terrible.
Yeah, he's gonna, you know, blow this one out of the park, which I no doubt that he will. He's incredible.
Did he tell you anything about it? Is it Japan or America, Godzilla?
I'm not sure. They did a little teaser they released at Comic-Con, and apparently it was just blew through the roof. It was the talk of the thing, and but nobody's seen the script yet. So
you've been to Comic-Con?
No, I've never been down there.
Oh, that shit is comedy.
I hear it's crazy. Crazy.
I don't even really get like. You know, Comic-Con's about comics and stuff, but then they'll just have, like, Drive premiere down there. You know, like, what? There's no comic there.
Now it's like a studio festival.
That's all it is.
You know?
It's like a Sundance.
Or like the stock market for studios. Buy, sell, trade.
Yeah, you know? That's what it is. It's so weird, man.
Yeah.
I don't get it. You like comic books?
I wasn't that big of a comic. It was the baseball card kid.
Oh, yeah?
You know what I mean? Comic books had some of the Ninja Turtles, some Archies, some... You know, but I wasn't that, you know, especially meeting people out here, I realized that I wasn't really that into it at all. You know?
Right.
As a kid, I thought I was, but.
So you're doing commercials, and then you start to get into movie auditions, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I've been hitting at it and going after it for 10, you know, 8 years, you know, hard. And
How many auditions before you got a film?
Theatrically, who knows, man, like one a week.
One a week.
You know, at minimum. You know what I mean? Sometimes more, sometimes a little bit, maybe a little bit less, I guess. But, you know, I don't think of it as like auditions. You know, I think about it as work. You know what I mean? Here, go in there, do this work.
You go see a coach when you got an audition?
Sometimes. I studied for like 4 years.
Oh, where at?
Everywhere. Joanne Barron Studio, Larry Moss Studio, Susan Batson, Moth Theater, John Marklin, you know, I just hit every coach I possibly could.
You recommend that?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You know, I don't think there's any one coach that's right for, this one coach may be great, you know what I mean? But just because they're great doesn't mean they're great for you.
Right.
It's about finding the match, who you get along with and who builds your confidence, you know, and who you're going to keep learning from. And
I think you just got to go coaching for auditions, because it seems to me once you get on the film, everybody's just the same. There's no magic. Like when I was doing a film, you know, the first film, you're thinking, okay, when they say action, this guy's going to change into some total different dude. Yeah. He was the same guy.
Yeah.
It was like action. He's like, we got to get a tire on this car. And then they go cut. And he's like, you guys want to go eat? It was the same dude.
Yeah,
there's no magic going on.
Well, it's I guess charisma. But I mean, in this day and age with films, it's a lot about bringing realism. You know what
it
I mean?
Is.
Who can be real? And there's surprisingly, that's some people can't do it. You know?
Yeah, I learned stuff by watching. You know, first couple films, like I find that I bobbed my head a lot on stuff.
Oh yeah, I used to bite my lower lip.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And it was an on-camera class I took 8 years ago, and they're like, look, you're just barely doing it, just the inside of your lip. And now I do it in the car.
Yeah.
But I was like, wow, I can't believe I'm doing it, and I'm not even aware of that.
Yeah, like when I was talking, I'd be like this, like, hey, man, yeah, you're talking about jazz, man.
You used to do that all the time.
Yeah. It's so weird, because that's how I talk.
Yeah.
And the director was like, what are you doing? Your head's bobbing, like a bobblehead. What the fuck are you doing?
Well, don't lose that, Dean.
Yeah, and I was like, hey, that's how I talk.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? No one else is doing it, so it looks cool. Right, you go to the
signature trademark of you in 20 years, like the Dean Del Rey bob.
Yeah, I want to get that bobblehead move going in. Or if somebody did it on the set, they go, nah, that's like the Del Rey bobblehead.
Well, what are you Del Reying over there for?
Yeah, exactly. But it's so weird when I see it, because I'm like, there's a scene where I'm watching TV and I'm just kind of like, yeah, you know, bobbing the head like it's telling me something. Because when you watch TV on movies, it's so fucked. It's the green screen.
There's
nothing there, and you're just looking like, oh yeah, go! Because it's a football game I'm watching. You know that?
Yeah.
God, it's funky, huh? Acting is so great and so funky at the same time.
It's so amazing and so bizarre and so trying.
It is.
Man, it's so...
You filmed in Shreveport at all?
I did.
It's so horrible,
That's where we shot the Killing Them Softly. I'm sorry. That was New Orleans.
Oh, New Orleans. No, same thing, like, you know...
But Shreveport's a little bit more desolate.
It is,
you know?
Man.
But it's got great fishing.
I don't know anything about fishing. You fish?
Big time.
No shit.
Love fishing. Love fly fishing, bass fishing.
Wow, like river runs through it kind of shit? Fly fishing, you're out there with the waders on. And
I
dig that. I went up to Billings, Montana. You ever been there?
I haven't fished Montana yet.
Let me tell you, that's where they did River Runs Through It, right?
Yeah.
So in Billings, Montana, there's a movie theater there. I forget what it's called. It's turned into this beautiful performance theater now, like comedy and music and stuff. Upstairs is this magic fucking loft. That's where David Lynch wrote Blue Velvet.
Get out.
I couldn't believe he lived in...
Well, he was living up there then.
He lived in Billings, Montana, lived in this movie theater and wrote Blue Velvet. So that area is pretty magic and weird up there.
God, that's so much more magical than the place I had in the Hollywood Hills. And someone was like, oh, that's the house that Tarzan was written in. Which is cool, but not as cool as that.
You had a badass house, man. That old Craftsman behind the Hollywood Bowl.
The wood cabin place.
What the fuck was that about?
That was the first house built on that hill.
Right.
And it was an old hunting lodge. And you can see a picture from where Yamashiro was.
Yep.
Shooting back towards the house. And you can see the observatory, I guess, in the back. And then you can't see any other houses on the mountain except for that house.
I thought it was one of the coolest houses I've been in. It's like, what was it built in, the 30s or something?
No, 1912. Yeah, like literally first like hunting cabin. Like,
it was giant Craftsman.
Yeah.
Big wood floors. It was so cool.
The old wood paneling on the side with all the woodwork. It's all, you know, pristine. And
yeah. The only bummer was how you parked.
Nowhere to park. And on a huge, huge, steep, steep street.
Steep street and weird hill to walk up to it.
But you know, that's what kept the crazies out on Friday and Saturday nights.
Because you get a little crazy.
Only the ones that were committed, you know, would come over.
You had some good parties, huh?
Yeah, we had some rocking parties there.
Yeah, I've been to a couple there. They were good.
I mean, I remember a couple times I was putting dishes away. The house was packed, and I looked over, and like Orlando Bloom was helping me put dishes in, and I was like, oh, what are you doing here?
it's weird how like Hollywood celebrities hear about a party.
Yeah.
I mean, you roll with Hollywood guys, though.
Yeah, somewhat. A lot of musicians, you know what I mean? I tend to like be more attracted to guys. It's great when I power around with some of my buddies, because I'm like, I'm doing this movie with Andrew Dominic, and they're like, oh, that's amazing, who's that?
Yeah,
you know, they're just happy for me.
That's
right.
What kind of music are you into right now? What are you listening to?
Man, I listen to a lot, man. Richard Halley,
yeah,
from the UK.
Yep.
I listen to him as soon as the weather starts dropping. I'll listen to him all the way through January.
Wow, really?
You know, and it's like very kind of Sinatra-y, like ripping steel guitars and
yeah.
You know, and then I'm trying to think of somebody, Truth and Salvage Company.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
that's our boys.
Oh yeah, I always go back to the Radiohead.
Radiohead.
You know what I mean?
Which record?
Kid A.
Kid A.
Yeah, for some reason, I think that came out right when I moved out here, and I geeked out on it for about 6 months, right when it first came out.
I'm the OK Computer.
OK Computer, I mean, there's so
And the one before that with Creep, or not Creep, that's the first one.
Yeah, Radiohead, not AMP, and that's Wilco.
Yeah, I can't remember either, man. Can you believe
how... like 11 albums.
Yeah, how long have they been around now? Isn't that amazing?
Creep came out when I was in high school.
Yeah.
So that was almost 15...
Wait, Creep is the second record, right? Is that the... I can't remember.
I don't know. Creep is what I feel like I know them from.
Well, that's the... Yeah, that's the big song.
That was
the
big one. And then all of a sudden they totally changed their whole...
The one, Fake Plastic Trees, that's the record I love, man. It's like, it's got the weird melting face on it.
Is the name of the record Fake Plastic Trees?
It might be. I don't know.
I don't know.
Man, that's weed, huh?
Look at us.
Hey, we're old.
Getting there.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, man, music. You go to Coachella a lot?
I did for the first...
We did. We used to go.
3 years, and then, not that it's corporatized, but it was so laid back. Back then, it was like you had a musician's pass,
yep,
a backstage pass, and a regular pass.
I try to tell people.
And now there's
great.
Like 9 different wristbands of 9 different places you can get
to.
It
sucks now.
Yeah, it's awful.
Sucks now. Back then, you could just get the right pass and just sit on stage and watch the band. You know what I mean? I remember shooting photos of Karen O. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's 2 feet away. I talked to her for a bit. I was in love with her. Totally. Still am. She's amazing.
I stood on stage watching Prodigy, you know, just go crazy, and Oasis on stage with them. And I don't even know how I ended up there. But,
yeah,
you know,
Beasties.
Yeah. Oh, man. Bjork played.
Yeah, Rage.
Chemical Brothers.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm a fire starter.
Yeah.
I'm a fire starter.
Yeah, Coachella's great, man. But, you know, it's gotten hotter out
it's
there.
It's kind of done now.
A little bit more busy, you know.
Yeah. So. You know, that's how it is. It's cool for a while. Now it's just a stupid thing where people go just to get their picture taken.
Yeah.
Or you know what I mean?
You know, if I go out there again, I'll probably just stay at the house I'm staying at.
Yeah, yeah.
And hope I can hear the concert from the house.
I'll go to the house and then just slip in for the one band I want to see, like Rage.
Yeah.
A couple years ago.
Did you see Rage Against the Machine?
That was unbelievable.
That was like their first time back.
That's right. It was a Sunday night. Went on at like 10:30 and just... blew that place.
Oh, man, I would have made that track.
Blew a hole in the ground, man, you know?
They were so cool. I mean, their CDs. We used to go mudding to their CDs in our trucks in Texas.
Oh, yeah.
Just crank kind of redneck
shit.
Yeah.
You're a Republican?
I'm a liberal.
Liberal?
Yeah, I'm Green Party.
It's tough to say you're a Republican in this town because you could get the fucking axe, right?
Yeah. Well, they just kind of like, yeah, defriend you.
That's right.
You know
it's true.
I mean?
It's like the old Red Party back in the day.
Yeah.
Right?
But it's tough. I mean, I wish that we would stop segregating our country from Democrats, Republicans, and get along and be one unity, you know?
Yeah.
I feel like they're going to put a line right down the Mississippi and say, you get over here and you guys get over here.
Well, the system's broke for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, you're out there in America like doing movies. I do too sometimes.
Yeah, man.
I'm touring as a comic or I do a movie somewhere and you live somewhere for a while, like Shreveport, you know? And I did a movie where there's a lot of extras on and you're talking to the extras and you're going like, man, this is bizarre. You know what I mean?
Man, I just came off a movie in Pittsburgh, you know, and it was about 45 miles east of Monroeville. And I was talking to these small guys in a small town and they were just telling me they have no more funding. I was talking to the guys at the fire station, like, who pays for the fire station? He goes, we all do it from donations. He goes, like, no cops? And I was like, what are you talking about? He's like, the whole state has just dumped. They're like, we're done with that town. If you guys want a fire department, you pay for it.
It's crazy.
Yeah, and I just couldn't believe it, man.
Yeah.
Like, they just left them to dry, you know?
It's so broken.
It's
you know
so
I mean?
Broken.
It's so broken. It blows my mind that no one has health insurance.
Mm.
I mean, we could talk fucking 5 podcasts on that because it's just bullshit. But it's just, you know, it's hard for me to get behind a cause, too, because it just seems so...
pointless.
Yeah, it really does, you know, man. And all of a sudden, you become this guy of like, fuck it. I've just got to get myself through.
Yeah.
You know?
Let me take care of myself, and then I could, you know what I mean? Because, like, times are tough, man.
They are, man. But we were just talking about that. People think you do some movies, right?
Yeah.
And they think you're just rich.
Yeah.
Like, let's talk about it. Like 40, you just did a $40 million movie, right?
Yeah.
And, like, what'd you get out of that?
Well, I probably shouldn't say.
Well, you don't have to say, you know.
But I mean, not a lot, you know what I mean? Right. Enough to live off of for a couple months, 3 or 4 months, you know. But you're so backtracked with bills that you owe.
That's right.
It barely just gets you back on your feet again.
What people don't understand is if you're going to do movies, you get a lump sum of money, and then you pay back every friend you borrowed money from.
Yes.
And then you're back to ground zero, and you feel good about yourself, like, okay, I've got that out of the way.
If you're lucky, you can get 3 jobs back to back, where you can kind of get in your head yourself, but it doesn't matter. If you don't get another job for a while, you're just going to go dig yourself right back in that ditch.
I know, it's really crazy.
So you got to love it, man. You really got to love what you do.
I do comedy every night, seven nights a week, right? Everybody goes, oh, man, how much they pay you? I go, pay? Nothing. They go, wait, you just did the Laugh Factory. I go, yeah, I got like $65, but the gas to get to the gigs was $90.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So you figure it out.
Hey, but I mean, like, the fulfillment you get from making people laugh, man.
I mean, if I was doing it for money, I would fucking be long gone.
Yeah.
I don't give a shit
on how they're paying you for that.
I don't give a shit about the money, man.
Yeah.
It's all about, I think in this day and age of life, get rid of any bullshit you have. Start over. Fuck it. Whatever you got to do. Bankruptcy, whatever. Get rid of all your high debt and do exactly what you want to do, because you know what? You're going to be dead pretty soon.
Yeah.
And if you just go like, oh, I worked at this shitty job forever, that's fucking stupid.
Yeah. Don't, you know, get out there, you know, do your thing and, you know.
For real.
Take risks. Go places.
Take risks, man.
My little sister even said to me, she was like, I was thinking about moving to Seattle for, like, she was 21 at the time, and she's thinking about moving to Seattle, but I just don't know, and I just don't. And I'm like, you're 21.
Yeah.
Move up there for 6 months. If you don't like it, move back.
Yeah.
You know, you got nothing to lose.
Yep. I moved to LA 11 years ago. Lived in San Fran, you know, Bay Area all my life. And I left, and people were like, whoa, what are you doing, man? You're going to LA and you're going to try. And look, my whole life changed. I toured the world with the Wallflowers.
Oh, yeah.
I went out with the Stones for 4 years. I did 5 major motion pictures.
And you did the thing with Fred Durst.
Yeah, I did the documentary on Fred Durst. Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah, those were funny.
I've done so much weird shit in 11 years.
Yeah, and you've had a great, you know, I was talking to this photographer, David Mushugan, the other day, and he was like, you know, just, he's successful, you know what I mean? And he's just, yeah, I can't believe the long ride. I'm like, 10 years? I'm like, yeah, dude, but you've had one of the greatest times over the last 10 years. And he just kind of smiled and was like, yeah, you're right.
I went around the world with the Stones.
Yeah.
You know what
I mean? Incredible, man.
How stupid is that? Like, and that was just a 300-mile move. On the earth, I moved 300 miles on the earth, and my whole life
opportunity
changed.
Brother. Fuck. I mean, I will say that about this city, you know, it's hard, but it is. There's so much opportunity here.
It's loaded with it.
And it's the last piece of America where if you work your ass off in this town,
yep,
you know, you'll get somewhere.
Yeah, I just did some comedy in Montana with Bobby Lee in Billings. And back it up, the original story I was saying was Missoula, Montana. I fucked it up.
I was about to say, Missoula, Montana.
I fucked it up. Billings is where I was recently. That's why I said Billings. Missoula is where River runs through it and all that was done. And good thing I remember that, because I'd see tweets like, hey, man, you're wrong on that. You better get your geography down. Hey, people are weird on there. This guy don't know what he's talking about. But Billings, and you know, guys say, hey, man, I'm doing comedy now. You got any suggestions for me? And I'm like, yeah, move. And they go, well, I can't move. And I go, well, then you're not going to do it. I mean, yeah, you can be a stand-up comic here. That's cool. I'm not knocking it. But don't ask me how you're going to get somewhere in the biz.
And then not take my advice.
Yeah, you know? And living in Billings, Montana, you know, because, like, I gave up everything in San Fran. I had a job where I was making, like, $150,000 DJing, and I gave it all up to come here. So you got to give your shit up.
Yeah, you really do, man. I mean, I remember making that same move out here from Austin, Texas, and just, you know, people were like, you know, what are you going to do out there? And even when I went back after 2 years, they're like, what are you doing, man? It's like, dude, I'm having a great time is
yeah.
what I'm doing.
Yeah, yeah. We're having a great time, dude, too. And that, like, blast, that fucking house on Gower. And, like, it was out. Like Big Pink, you know, the band. People just playing in there 24/7.
That house is still in our group of friends.
That's unbelievable.
My buddy Andy Clockwise lives there, who's a musician from Australia. And yeah. my buddy Joey Capone lives there.
There's this house, if people are listening, it's on Gower. At Gower. I live in Beechwood Canyon. If you live around America listen to this, or just in the world, some people in Australia listen, we live underneath the Hollywood sign. There's an incredible community there called Beechwood Canyon, loaded with artists. You got UCB there. You have some incredible people living here.
Yeah, you got great, all kids from 20 to 40 years old. Everybody's just kind of doing the same thing. They're all artists. You know, yeah. everybody's going after something. It's a community. Everybody helps out everybody with everything
else. It's unbelievable.
It's really cool. It's a beautiful thing. That,
and this particular house I happen to land next door to. Because
yeah.
I was playing music and a guitar player bought this house and
yeah,
I moved
your hot
in.
Hot rod out there.
Yeah, the
blue.
Super B.
Yeah, I think yeah. it was badass.
Yeah, yeah, I was total white trash. Super yeah. B and a Harley.
Yeah.
Just, yeah.
We were all, I mean.
Selling weed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I was trying to be badass back then.
Yeah, just whatever. Yeah, but this house had a band in it and some of the finest women in the planet were rolling through there.
Yeah.
Just yeah, that are like famous actresses
yeah.
now and stuff.
Oh yeah,
but this area is incredible, right? Like when I landed here, I landed in Silver Lake first, and that just felt too far away.
Yeah.
Then I lived behind the Comedy Store on Queens Road for a while, and
oh,
that
really?
Just kind of felt like yeah, I liked it, but it was way up on the hill.
Yeah.
Then when I landed here, when you kind of land in Beechwood, you're just like oh.
It's when you find these people here in Beechwood.
That's what it
you're
is.
Like, oh, these people are cool. They're, you know, they're not you know this or that, and they're just. Really genuine human beings. You
well,
know?
You get people that are working in the biz that aren't dicks.
Yeah.
You're just going like, whoa, these guys. Like, no. I go to the movie theater and I see you in a movie and I go, hey, I know that guy. You
yeah.
know what I mean? Like, I was telling my buddy a couple of nights ago, we were at the Master and I see you on the trailer and you're on the whole trailer.
Yeah.
And I'm like, hey, man, I know this guy, like, not like in passing.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
But
yeah.
I'm going to call him tomorrow and get him on the podcast. You know
what
I mean?
That's great, man.
Yeah.
Well, it's great to hang out with you. See, I guess last time I saw you, I caught you at the Comedy Store about 3 or 4 months ago.
Yeah, you came to a show. How'd you like it?
Loved it, man. It was great, man. I hadn't been in there in years, you know, but it was great, man. Like, your act is getting better and better and better, and it's super fucking funny. And
yeah, it's hard.
Yeah, I know, man. I know. I honestly don't know how you guys come up with the material and then do it all the time.
It's
and
hard.
Keep the good attitude about it.
Yeah, I know. It's you know, I think the hardest part about it is you get an idea and you go, this is great, and you go down to the club to do it. Right before you do it, the guy before you is doing something similar.
Oh man!
Because you have that same train of thought, you
yeah.
know. And,
or picking up a theme off the person's show before and working it into your show, you know what I mean?
Well, that's easy to do. Like
yeah.
if you're just running off that, but you know, there's that. I find with comedy, you have to just dig completely into yourself and only talk about yourself, because if you talk about pop culture or anything, everybody's doing it.
Yeah.
And they're going to cover the same kind of ground and stuff. So you got to steer away from that, you know?
That's a good lesson, you know? I mean, I didn't even think about that. Yeah, if you just go internal.
That's
and
it.
Talk about your flaws
that's
and
right.
like, what pisses you off. And
last night I did a new joke about, like, I'm hooked on candy, right? I'm working on this thing. I'm totally a candy junkie, but I'm a sugar junkie. And
yeah.
this guy gave me some pot cookies, and I don't fuck around with weed anymore or anything, you know, because it fucks up my memory.
Yeah.
So he gave me these 3 pot cookies, and he was like, here, man, here's some pot cookies. And I was like, I'll just give them to somebody else, you know. I'm not going to say, oh, I don't do weed, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm such a sugar addict that my mind, after a couple hours, went, those probably aren't really pot cookies.
Oh,
you
they don't have that much in there.
You should eat them.
Yeah.
So I ate all 3, and about an hour later, I got a text from him and said, oh, by the way, only eat like 1. And man, they started kicking in, and I was fucking gone. And I was on my bike. I had to ride home.
No.
Sky was orange. I was all fucked up. I was like, I was like, I felt like I was the witch on Wizard of Oz on the broom. Like,
that's dangerous, Dean.
Oh, it was dangerous.
I have to say.
I pulled off and kind of slept under the bike on the like side street. Just trying to ride it
out. Peter Fonda style.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. So you've got some big movies coming out this year.
Yeah, man. 11 years overnight success.
Yeah, yeah. Like you do two in 1 year. Let's talk about the first one. Let's talk about Argo. I got some friends in Argo, which is amazing. David Sullivan, he's an acting coach.
Yeah. I know David, yeah.
And then
yeah.
my other buddy, Amir Kay, is a comedian. I think he's playing one of the terrorist kind of dudes or whatever.
Wait. I want to say he's the tour guide for us when we're in...
Maybe. I'm not sure.
I haven't seen it. I'm not sure either.
I saw the trailer recently, and boy, is it funny looking, because it's in the 70s, right?
Good times. 1979.
Tell us what the story's about.
Story's a true story about student movement group in Iran took over the United States Embassy in 1979, and it's something they had done before, and they thought it was going to, you know, go last a day. And
in Iran?
In Iran, yeah. Right. And they ended up taking everybody hostage. Well, true story, six people from the embassy escaped out the back, and they went to the British embassy. And weren't able, they were like, you can't stay here, you know, it's too risky. And they went to this other embassy, you can't stay there. Well, the Canadian ambassador took them in. The CIA...
Why wouldn't the British people take them in? Like, hey, we got kidnapped. And they just go, yeah, let's go get those guys.
I think it was because they get shot. You know what I mean? They were just killing people. And so they kept all these hostages.
Is that during the Ayatollah Khomeini?
Oh, like, yeah. This is the exit of the Shah.
Right.
And the Ayatollah Khomeini comes back in.
I remember. He was just crazy.
Yeah. This is right when that happened.
Yep.
And anyways, these six people flee the thing, and they get put up in the the Canadian ambassador's place. And the CIA devises a plan to sneak them out through the airport using Canadian fake passports and faking them as a film production crew on a scout.
That's right. It looks pretty good, actually.
Yeah. And
now, who's in this film? There's big guys.
Ben Affleck, he's directing it and playing the lead. He's incredible. He was one of the most amazing directors I've ever worked with. He's the most down-to-earth.
I heard he was so cool. He even talked to, like, extras and stuff. My buddy's, like, an extra.
Oh, yeah.
Sam Sheik, I call him.
Yeah, he was so cool, man. And he was, on top of that, amazing filmmaker. And then it's got Alan Arkin.
Oh, yeah.
John Goodman. And the two of them together are incredible.
John Goodman, awesome.
Yeah, I want to see them in another movie again. Yeah. And then who I worked with, Bryan Cranston's in it.
Oh, amazing, Breaking Bad.
And then I worked on it with Clea DuVall, Rory Cochrane, Victor Garber, Tate Donovan, Chris Denham, and Carrie Bechet.
And where'd you guys shoot it?
We shot all the interior of the house for Iran in Hancock Park, and then we went over to Istanbul, Turkey, and shot for 3 weeks for exteriors.
What was that like?
Awesome, dude. I went to a Turkish soccer game.
You smoke any of that hash over there? They got hash there?
No, I was a little worried. I was a little iffy. Yeah. I was kind of on good
behavior. You don't want to get in trouble.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
That, and also I just didn't, you know, I've been to jail in some foreign countries. And
you
have? Yeah, so it's a little, went to jail in Switzerland, went to jail in London.
Oh, yeah.
You know, kid stuff.
Yeah, kids. Stuff.
Kids.
Yeah. Little vandalism.
Yeah. And so, yeah, man, it's really cool. It comes out, I think, October 15th. Don't quote me on that.
Have you seen it?
I did. I caught it up in Toronto Film Festival just about 2 weeks ago.
How's it look?
It's good, man. I got to say, I don't usually say that about films that I'm in because I'm biased. But I honestly watched this movie and was not paying attention to myself.
Oh, yeah, that's cool. Are you in a big role on it? You're one of the guys that gets kidnapped?
Yeah, I'm a supporting role.
That's awesome.
You know, I play Joe Stafford. So, but yeah, go check it out, man. It's good. It's definitely, you know, it's great to see Ben come off of The Town, who he directed, you know, Gone Baby Gone, then The Town, and then this. It's like, I feel like he's got three solid films under his belt.
That guy's a fucking...
He's a machine, man.
Yeah, that guy works, man.
Yeah.
Now, your next film, Killing Them Softly, when does this come out?
Killing Them Softly right now is slated for November 30th.
That's Brad Pitt.
With Brad Pitt, man.
Come on,
the man. The man, BP.
Did you know Brad Pitt before that?
I didn't. I did not know him. I hadn't met him. And I, on this particular job, I opted to not meet him.
Really?
Yeah, I was like, you know what? We don't have it. I'm really like, as an actor, to harness on chemistry. Yeah. You know, so if, you know, me and you did a movie together, we already got chemistry. But I'd want to hang out with you every day. But our characters didn't know each other in the movie.
Oh, so yeah.
So I flipped it, went the complete opposite. It was like, I don't even want to meet him. Just right. like walk him in and let's just do the scene and see what happens. And I'll put all that nervous energy into the scene.
Yeah.
And
now, first of all, how do you even get this film? Let's talk about it a little bit because
auditioning.
You auditioned right. How many times?
That only twice, but how many times before that? Thousands.
Well, you I understand that, but you go in for it and they go pretty good and they do call back and then you get it?
No, I went in and read for the assistant. You know, the casting director wasn't there, and I was doing this Boston accent that was like this really sick malnutritioned kid. I was just throwing it out there thinking I'll never get this job.
Yeah. And what was the sound like, the Boston accent?
He kind of talks like this. It's hard for me to do it. It's hard for me to get really into it, but he's kind of sick and talks a little bit in his throat a little bit.
And is that when you were reading the sides, that's what you got out of it?
Yeah, it's like how these certain words, like Anna, like it was I-N-A, that was a word, like Anna, you know? And So I kind of took as much as I could from that, and I went in and read for it, and I guess the director saw it and just watched the tape, like, 500 times. It was like, who is this kid? This kid's great. I want this kid. And by this time, I'm sure the studio was like, oh my God, are you kidding me? Like, no, please hire somebody that's bankable.
Yeah, like Shia LaBeouf or something.
Yeah. Right? So he called me, or I got a call when I was up at Sundance going, you need to fly back into town. I was like, dude, I'm fly fishing.
Uh-huh.
It's in the middle of winter. I was fly fishing. I was like, I just got here. I'm fishing for the next 3 days. I'm not coming back.
Yeah.
Like, you got to come back on Sunday to read. I'm like, man, I'm not going to get this job. I'm not going to fly all the way back. And I was frustrated.
Oh, it's the worst, huh?
And they were like, fly back. And I was like, fine. Well, on top of that, he gave me a 3-page monologue to memorize.
Oh, wow.
In 3 days. Hopped on a plane, flew back, read for him once, took the earplugs out of his ears and goes, all right. You know what I mean?
Wow.
Walked downstairs and said, do you want the job? And I was like, give a fuck yourself, I'm going to get this job. Even then, I was like, clear it with everybody over at Business Affairs.
Yeah, because they're going to go like, no.
And then he called me.
People don't understand, man. They just say no because we need a name on this because the people that are putting the money into the films
want their money back.
They say no.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And so he took a huge risk on casting me, and I hope he's happy.
What's his name?
Andrew Dominik. He did Assassination of Jesse James.
Love that film.
By the coward Robert Ford. One of my top 10 favorite films. And he did another movie called Chopper.
Love that film. That's a masterpiece.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, Chopper. What's the story about?
It's pretty much about these low-life thugs, degenerates, idiots.
You're one of them.
And I'm one of them, played opposite of Ben Mendelsohn, who's an incredible actor. And we go knock off this mafia-protected card game.
Right.
And, then they, the mafia hitman, Brad Pitt, has, said this card game's been knocked off. We need you to go find out who did it and kill him.
Right.
And so it's kind of a cat and mouse type game. But with that being said, there's a whole bunch of, like, comedic sort of political undertones that are intertwined throughout the film.
Right, yeah. I could get that from the trailer.
Yeah.
Because at first, when I saw it, I'm hoping for, like, a cool mafia murder film.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's going to be Iceman this year.
That looks so good.
That looks great, huh?
Michael Shannon, man.
Yeah, come on.
He's constantly knocking it out of the park.
So, your first scene with Brad Pitt, he comes in, and what's that like?
Man, I was a little bit nervous, you know what I mean? Going, I hope this is the smart decision to make. And he came in, we did the scene once. There was probably about 10 seconds there. I was looking at him, and I was like, oh, yeah, I'm working with Brad Pitt. And then after about 10 seconds, my next line, it went away, and it never came back, and it was just about the work.
Right.
Because
to me, Brad Pitt, it's not like working with, Steve Buscemi or like a Giamatti or a Philip Seymour where you're like, these guys are God. It's just more of like, because to me, I'm not really a big Brad Pitt fan. I love how he looks. He looks cool as fuck all the time. He rides great bikes. But I loved him in California, but not much else. I'm not like a Brad Pitt guy. What has he done?
Well, I was a fan, man. From just like his choices that he's made, the films that he's picked, down to Interview with the Vampire.
The old one.
And,
California, I thought was awesome.
Seven.
Seven and Fight
Club was good.
But then after that,
12 Monkeys.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so.
But then you get into kind of, what was it, Gladiator? Did he do that? Or not that, but that. He-Man kind of one.
Troy.
Then he does the one with his lady.
Yeah, Mr. and Mrs. Smith.
Yeah, and then he does. I mean, he does, and he does a Coen Brothers film that's like probably the least watched ever.
Which Coen Brothers movie?
It was like kind of that weird little one where he's the he's trying to. I guess it's he's got the computer hard drive.
Yeah. Burn.
That's a weird one because it comes out after the masterpiece No Country for Old Men. Yeah. So that thing just gets fucking hidden. You know?
I like. He was so great in that though. Playing this like gym, like kind of like quirky.
But to me, he's not like dudes, man.
Well, the thing is he, you know, there was intimidation there, but he's the most down to earth.
Oh yeah,
nicest, super professional, greatest guy.
Yep.
But I just didn't get any of that going into it, so I had all this like, you know, built up. You know,
right?
You know,
did his lady come by the set?
No.
Well, that's weird. Where'd you guys shoot this?
We shot that in New Orleans.
Oh, New Orleans.
He loves shooting in New Orleans because he's done so much to rebuild that city.
Yeah, he did. They did all that stuff after Katrina, right? He's got a pad there.
Yeah, and he's still constantly, all he wants to do is bring business to that town.
Yeah, he's a good dude.
Yeah, really good guy, man. He's got, you know, so many like...
I mean, that guy could easily be a dick.
Oh, easily.
I mean, good looking dude. Still looks great. How old is he? Like 40 or something? He looks fantastic.
Yeah, he looks like he's about 38, 39, 40.
Yeah, he's got one of the coolest pads here in Beechwood, the Craftsman kind of hunting lodge over there, man. And the guy is just, you know, the goods, man.
Yeah, he's got it going on, man, and he's got a good attitude about it, it seems.
That's
like,
great. You know? I can't wait till he discovers me.
Yeah, right.
Actually, I was selling a motorcycle about 3 months ago for a guy. I was middlemaning this $100,000 bike.
Yeah.
And I get a call from a guy, and he says, are you firm on the price? It's like $75,000, you know? I said, yeah, the guy's firm on the price. I don't even tell
him. What kind of bike was it?
It was a West Coast chopper, Jesse James.
Okay.
And he said, okay, I'll call you back. Calls me back. He says, my client wants to see it, but he's in Japan right now. Well, at the time, I didn't know, but Brad had a new movie come out, and he was promoting it in Japan. This is about 6 months ago or something. I forget what it was just in. So he said, my client wants to see it. When can we meet? And I said, well, I live over in Beechwood. He goes, oh, my client's over there, too. And then I go, oh, well, who the fuck is your client? It sounds so dumb, my client. This is a chopper.
Yeah.
It's not a fucking home.
It's Bob or Rich or Dave wants the bike.
Yeah, exactly. It's a
Bradley.
And he goes, well, my client's Brad Pitt. And I was like, oh, all right, well, cool. I know what bikes he has. I know his collection. So this would be the best bike in his collection. So
we'll just put it that way if he still wants to see a picture.
Yep. And then the guy tried to lowball me a little bit. I was like, really? Brad Pitt's throwing a lowball? But I think what Brad was doing was probably saying, I'll pay this amount. And this guy was middlemaning to make some money also.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Two middlemen battling over the client's money. You know what I mean? So hilarious, because I was like, really? Brad's coming at me with that? You know I know the money.
And
he
Brad
makes.
Would have been upset had he known that it was lowballing Dean Del Rey.
Yeah. You
know
he was like, yeah, just give it to him.
It's Dean. Oh, I didn't know. Okay, time out. Stop. Pay him what he needs.
Yeah, man. Well, shit, man. You've got some great success going on.
Thanks, man. I really put my... I really focused on the work and kept hitting the pavement. And when the people tell me to quit, you just keep at it, man.
What do you got coming up? Anything?
I just did another movie with Brad.
You did?
Called 12 Years a Slave.
Another fucking Brad Pitt film?
Yeah, with this director, Steve McQueen, who did Hunger and Shame.
Wow.
Who I was like the, you know...
And where'd you guys shoot that at?
New Orleans.
Again. You know, and what's it about?
It's about a slave in 1844, I believe, that gets... he's a freedman.
Yep.
He gets... conned into going on the road show and put into slavery and sold into slavery in Washington, D.C., and then later gets shipped down to New Orleans and works on the plantations. And finally, he's, you know, got his papers and everything. And like people, he's a freed man.
Yeah.
And so after 12 years, he finally breaks loose and gets back to his family. It's a true story.
Well, and another film with Brad Pitt.
Yeah.
Did Brad recommend you or something?
No, I mean, I think he probably maybe champions me, but he's like, you know, I can't offer you anything. You got to go audition. You know what I mean? Like,
is that what he said to you?
Dee Dee Gardner, his producer was like, look, you know what I mean? Like, we love Scoot, but we can't tell Steve McQueen, the director, who to hire.
So you got Brad's phone number? No. Like, this is what I think is funny about on movie sets.
Dude, he's Brad Pitt, busy, man. He's got a family.
No, I understand that. But, you know, when you're in New Orleans or Shreveport, like I am, like Ice Cube is like, what are you doing tonight after set? You want to go eat? Here's my number. Text me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, you know, I never ask, but you could, you know, if the opportunity presents itself or it's organic,
yeah,
then great. You know what I mean? But usually I don't, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I understand. You're professional. You're not like me, because with me, I'm always thinking, this is the last film I'm doing for sure.
Well, I still feel that way. I definitely still feel like that. But yeah, I don't. And I never talk on the phone. I never really, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't either.
I'm not a big reacher outer. I'm kind of like, I love running into people.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I run into you, like, at the 101.
Constantly, all the time,
like,
man.
Yeah, and it's like, oh,
it's
hey.
Always great. It's like, Dean Del Rey!
Yeah, yeah! Well, fuck, man. You got a great, some great shit coming up.
Cheers, bro.
And cheers. I'm happy for you, man. That's cheers, so cool. Brother. And make sure you put in a word for me.
Oh, like, absolutely.
You ever hear
man.
That? It's so dumb when people say that.
No, hey, but it's a given.
But it's hilarious when people go, hey, man, maybe you could, you know, hook me up with your agent or something. Yeah, that's how it works.
I know. The thing is I wish that I could.
It doesn't work.
And people kind of just don't get that.
You know what, like, I always say? Go do the fucking work.
Yeah.
Like,
stop
you did the work.
Looking away for all these ways around.
Just stop with the fucking secret back door. There is
classes,
none.
Do some plays and, like, learn the shit.
Learn the shit.
You know?
Learn the crap. Like me, I do fucking open mics every night. People go, hey, you're on at the Comedy Store. Why are you doing an open mic? Because I suck.
But see, you know what? You're so trained and well known that opportunity presents itself that someone's like in New York City and so-and-so is sitting in the crowd and is like, Dean, the guy's off, and you're so well trained that you knock it out of the park. The guy sees it, and you know what I mean.
That's it.
It's like constantly being ready, constantly being prepared.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
I'm always ready for the guy that discovers me, and then I blow up, and then everybody else is like, "We always loved you."
Yeah,
well, I love that one. It's like, eat a dick.
That's
man.
Hollywood, man.
Yeah,
like,
I love it.
Tell you the people that are coming out of the woodwork. It's like, I know right now. A fan. I'm like, I could have sworn verbatim you said Scoot is the worst actor I've ever met.
Yeah. You know? How about this one? I don't know. He's kind of old and tattoos. What would we do with him? What do you mean, what do you do with him? No one else is that. He would be your guy, you idiot. Like, we need the tattooed biker. Got him. We need the tattooed soccer coach. Got him. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? It's just crazy how people think. They're so in the box, you know?
Yeah,
like,
man.
Comedy in movies is starting to turn into like music, where it's only good looking dudes, and it's like music died from it.
Image,
and just, it died. Music. I mean, like, Jack White is a god. He would never get a deal on like fucking you know Columbia. Like, you know what I mean?
Product, man.
Product. Yeah, they just want to fucking throw those Amanda Barnes or whatever. You know.
But you know.
Oh, speaking of that, you did Herbie, right?
Small. Well, I don't even know. I didn't see it, but I don't even know. I had one line, not even a line. I think I had a word.
A word.
I don't know, but I don't think it made it into the movie. But I think I made it into the movie as like a glorified extra, essentially, which is funny because that was like, you know, I was doing extra work like years before that, and then here I am on this job that I got a line, but I essentially worked 30 days on it just still as an extra.
30, yeah.
If the Herbie was there, I was there next to
it. Oh, were you like a mechanic
or
something?
I was like the mechanic or like the guy keeps...
Oh, I remember seeing your trailer. You're the wacky dude. Like, hey!
Yeah. And then like, you know, and I remember just standing next to Michael Keaton and he talks so quiet. Like,
talks creepy.
And it's like, I think, I feel like in the shot, in the scene with him, I'm like leaning in trying to listen.
Oh.
You can hear my ear. Like,
yeah, I can't hear that good anyway. And when guys are doing their lines, I'm like, really quiet. Fuck, I can't hear, you know?
But yeah, man, I tell you, the coolest thing about that job was I got to stand in pit row on the wall during the Nextel Cup NASCAR race.
Oh, that's cool.
Which was just pure on adrenaline. They don't let anybody down there, and they made an exception for us to shoot the reverse.
Yeah.
You know, of that. And so I was just kind of totally geeking out on all the engines and cars and, you know.
That's cool, man.
Rad, yeah.
Where can anybody find you? You got a Twitter or like how do people?
Not on Facebook. No.
Me either.
I got a Twitter account that a guy set up for me in Toronto. I don't know how to use it. I don't know how to work it, but I get an email once I go out while saying so and so's following me on Twitter. So eventually, once I figure it out, I heard I could post pictures on it.
Well, yeah, right. What's the.
So I want to start catching these fish and, you know.
Yeah, you got to do that. That's cool
fish
shit.
And tweeting them, you know.
What's the biggest fish you caught?
Biggest fish I caught was probably like a 38-pound barracuda.
Wow.
You know what I mean? But as far as trouts go, probably about a 6-pound rainbow.
Wow.
Which gets pretty big. And then about a 8-pound largemouth bass.
Wow, that's
bass
cool.
Side, yeah.
Yeah, well, fuck, man.
Yeah, man.
Get out there and get some fishing going. Thanks for coming by.
Shit, yeah, dude.
What was your Twitter? Did you know the handle?
I think it's Scoot McNary.
Oh, there you go.
I'm pretty sure.
So, S-C-O-O-T.
S-C-O-O-T-M-C-N-A-I-R-Y.
At Scoot McNary.
At Twitter or whatever
that's
the thing
just
is.
Like it's twitter.com at Scoot Monero. There you go.
Okay, yeah, there you go.
Cool, follow him, everybody, and tell him you heard him on Let There Be Talk.
Shit, yeah, guys, thanks for tuning in.
Yeah! Thanks, buddy. All right, guys, don't forget to tell your friends about Let There Be Talk and give us a good review right there on iTunes. And go see Scoot's films, man. This guy's awesome. I love him. Thanks for tuning in. See ya.